Dr. Jason Fung's book, The Obesity Code, demonstrates that counting calories for weight loss and exercise for weight loss are both miserable failures. But a low-carbohydrate diet and intermittent fasting weight loss strategies are really the most effective options. If you've wondered whether The Obesity Code is worth your time, I'm here to help. I'm Steve Goldring from SimpleHormones.com. I help patients and healthcare practitioners with easy-to-understand patient information resources, mostly about the power of optimal hormones. So what does obesity have to do with hormones? Plenty. We'll talk about that. Stick around to the end of this video, and I'll give you a quick bullet point summary, a list of hormones that are involved in obesity. If you know of a patient education resource, a book, a website, or a study that you'd like to see me review, drop a comment in the space below and I'll see what I can do. Be sure to like this video and subscribe to my channel to get notified whenever I post a new review. In The Obesity Code, Dr. Fung starts his paradigm-busting explanation of obesity by taking a look at what it is and what it isn't. Obesity is an epidemic. Chapter 1 is all about the obesity epidemic and how it came to be. Just within the last 40 or 50 years or so, the percentage of people struggling with obesity in America and around the world has absolutely exploded. It's no secret that we're fatter and more unhealthy than we've ever been. Along with obesity in the U.S. comes a long list of chronic diseases, things like heart disease, diabetes, Alzheimer's, fatty liver disease. Those have all skyrocketed in lockstep with obesity over the past 4 to 5 decades. Obesity is not caused by excess calories. Fung talks about the idea of a proximate cause as opposed to an ultimate cause. The cause of obesity might appear to be eating too many calories or not getting enough exercise. It's the common concept that calories in equals calories out. Well, calories in, calories out is a nice little sing-songy phrase, but it's way too simplistic to explain what actually happens in obesity. Calorie excess might look like the cause of obesity. If we kind of assume that a person is eating more than they should or exercising less than they should, we kind of automatically also assume some sort of character defect. There's a subtle, if usually unspoken, judgment about obese people. Our judgment of the obese or overweight is rooted in the two sins, gluttony, or eating too much, and sloth, or exercising too little. It doesn't take long to dismantle this whole obesity as a personal choice paradigm. After puberty, men eat way more calories than women, except women tend to have a higher body fat percentage. Calories in, calories out doesn't really explain that. Women are not more gluttonous or lazier than men. Pregnancy causes women to gain a lot of weight. Is that just due to the fact that they eat too much or exercise too little? Of course not. These situations are evidence that weight gain and obesity are controlled by hormones. The counting calories weight loss strategy and calorie tracking has really proven itself to be only a short-term solution to obesity. There's just so much more at play than just calories. Obesity is not about too little exercise. Calories in, calories out also breaks down when it comes to relying on exercise for weight loss. Sure, bumping up your activity level can make a difference in weight temporarily, but over the long term, your body's own metabolism tends to make adjustments to conserve energy and compensate for that extra energy that you're burning through exercise. Fung uses an analogy of the manager of a coal-fired power plant that supplies electricity to a small city. Let's say the plant normally receives 2,000 tons of coal each day, and we have a little coal stored in a shed just in case of emergency. Our coal supplies suddenly drop, for some reason, to only 1,500 tons a day. So if we continue burning 2,000 tons every day, it's just not long before we start to run completely out of fuel and we're unable to provide electricity to our customers. Well, the wise plant manager won't continue burning 2,000 tons a day when she only has 1,500 tons coming in. Instead, she'll make some cutbacks so she's burning only 1,500 tons a day. Well, some customers may experience brownouts, but the majority will be okay and the plant can still function. The same thing happens within our bodies when we cut calories, let's say from 2,000 calories down to 1,500. Our bodies are smart enough to know that they need to decrease our metabolic rate, or the rate that we burn fuel, so we don't run completely out and die. Dr. Fung cites the giant Women's Health Initiative study as evidence supporting the idea that exercise for weight loss is pretty ineffective. In that study, 40,000 women were divided into three groups with high, medium, and low levels of exercise. After 10 years, there was no weight difference among the three groups. The hormone theory of obesity. Fung proposes a new theory, the hormonal theory of obesity, to explain why we get obese. He says obesity is not caused by excess calories, but by a body set weight that's too high because of a hormonal imbalance in the body. A set weight is sort of like a thermostat that keeps your body weight where it should be. Dr. Jason Fung says the caloric view of obesity relies on five assumptions that simply aren't true. Assumption number one is that calories in and calories out are independent of each other. The hormonal theory explains why calories in and calories out are actually tightly synced together. Assumption number two is that basal metabolic rate is stable. The hormonal theory explains how hormone signals adjust our basal metabolic rate, the fuel burning rate, to either gain or lose weight, to store or burn fuel. Assumption number three is that we exert conscious control over calories in. The hormone theory explains that hunger and satiety or satiation, those are regulated by hormones that play a role in determining whether we eat or not. It's not your fault. Assumption number four is that fat stores are essentially unregulated. Well, the hormonal theory explains that fat stores, just like every body system, those are tightly regulated and they respond to changes in food intake and activity levels based on hormone activity. Assumption five is a calorie is a calorie is a calorie. Well, the hormonal theory explains why different calories cause different metabolic responses. Sometimes calories are used to heat the body. At other times, they're stored as fat. The two hormones most likely to cause weight gain, according to Fung, are insulin and cortisol. Fung says he can easily make you fat. All he has to do is start giving you insulin injections. Weight gain is an established, documented side effect for almost all type 2 diabetics taking insulin. Cortisol, or more commonly used variants like cortisone and prednisone, are widely known to cause weight gain and fat deposits. The converse is also true. If either insulin or cortisol levels go down, you can generally lose weight more easily. Fung writes and speaks a lot about insulin resistance. That's a situation where insulin stops moving glucose from the bloodstream into the cells. Because glucose transport isn't working quite right, the glucose backs up into the blood, leading to elevated blood glucose or hyperglycemia. Elevated blood glucose sends a message to the pancreas that it needs to secrete more insulin. Extra insulin leads to hyperinsulinemia, and all that extra insulin does help a little with the blood glucose, but eventually it stops working again, leading to more blood glucose and more insulin, and it's kind of a vicious cycle. There was a study in 1993 that demonstrated high levels of insulin, while they may control blood glucose, also cause insulin resistance. Fung has an unorthodox theory that's also elegantly simple about insulin resistance. Take a look at my review of his other book, The Diabetes Code, to learn more about that interesting paradigm. I've got a link to that video at the end of this one. Of course, glucose is a major player in type 2 diabetes. Type 2 is diagnosed when patients have blood glucose levels above 126 milligrams per deciliter, or long-term blood glucose levels, they're called hemoglobin A1C, that are over 6.5%. Another big player in diabetes, the twin metabolic diseases affecting so many of us, is fructose. Fructose is found naturally in fruit. It's also half of the sugar that's found in ordinary table sugar, along with glucose. Fructose has been a major component of the standard American diet for at least 40 years because it's added to thousands of processed foods in the form of high fructose corn syrup. It's a sweet tasting, cheap additive. Fructose doesn't raise blood glucose or insulin, at least not as much as glucose does. What fructose does do, though, is cause insulin resistance. Fructose metabolism can only be accomplished inside the liver, unlike glucose, which can be used by almost every other kind of cell. A 2009 study showed that healthy volunteers given high levels of fructose started developing insulin resistance within 6 days. After 8 weeks, they had prediabetes. Natural fruit consumption was giving us maybe 15 to 20 grams of fructose per day. It was significant, but not outrageous. But as high fructose corn syrup started showing up in almost every food, especially those sugary sodas and fruit drinks, consumption of fructose has skyrocketed up to 73 grams a day, especially for kids. The other major issue with fructose, besides insulin resistance leading to obesity, is non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. High levels of fructose go straight to your liver. Fructose metabolism mainly stores it as fat right in the liver. Long-term high intake of fructose starts packing more and more fat into the liver until fatty liver symptoms and signs start to appear. Actually, the symptoms don't really show up until your liver's in really bad shape, but your labs will show elevated liver enzymes with NAFLDE. Fatty liver diet treatment would include drastically cutting back on sugar, which, as you'll recall, is 50% fructose, as well as cutting out fruit. Fatty liver treatments might also include some level of alternate day intermittent fasting and time-restricted eating. That kind of allows the liver to clear out the glycogen and stored energy, followed by clearing out liver fat. Time-restricted eating or intermittent fasting. Fung pins some of the blame for insulin resistance and obesity on snacks. When we were kids, our moms let us eat breakfast, lunch, and dinner. They told us it wasn't good for us to eat between meals. In 1977, a survey of 60,000 adults and kids found that they ate about three meals a day. But there's been a major change of mind the past couple of decades. The consensus, even among healthcare professionals, has been that snacking is not only okay, but it's somehow better for you. Unfortunately, snacking seems to make insulin resistance and obesity much worse. Snacking never allows blood glucose or insulin levels to return to a baseline. Continuously feeding glucose causes higher and higher insulin levels and drives insulin resistance and obesity. One easy and free way to reduce insulin resistance is to reduce the number of meals. It's our first baby step toward intermittent fasting. Beyond snacks, intermittent fasting has been shown to have a big impact on insulin resistance. Fung's a huge proponent of fasting as an age-old way of controlling energy input. It's the simplest way to lose weight. Don't eat for a period of time. Fung isn't talking about starving yourself. It's about training your body to eat when it needs food and fast for periods long enough to allow glucose and insulin levels to drop. He includes an appendix called Fasting, a practical guide. It goes over simple plans for both a 24-hour and a 36-hour intermittent fast. Each one has its benefits for weight loss, ridding the liver of stored glycogen and fat, and increasing insulin sensitivity. Jason Fung's obesity treatment is all about what you eat and when you eat. Of course, the Obesity Code diet is the punchline of the book. What diet steps should we take to lose weight? Number one, reduce our consumption of added sugar. That's sugar that comes from processed foods, from desserts, from snacks, beverages. Number two, reduce refined grains like wheat flour in favor of less refined and lower glycemic grains. Number three, moderate protein consumption. Number four, increase natural fats, especially olive oil, fat, avocados, nuts. Increase the protective factors like fiber and vinegar and fermented foods. Fat, carbs, protein. These are the big dials in diet. Actually, the only dials. If you increase one, you decrease another, or you end up eating too many calories. It's a simple system. The Obesity Code diet plan is a low-carbohydrate, high healthy fat diet focused on whole unprocessed foods. The majority of energy in the diet comes from fat and protein, and a small minority comes from carbohydrates. Fung's book makes it clear that calorie intake is just one part of obesity. Exercise is also a part, but a very small one at best. The hormonal theory of obesity explains away all five of the big assumptions that we've taken as truth. It helps us understand that hormones are the keys to weight gain and weight loss. First, insulin levels are closely tied to weight gain and increased fat storage. Increasing insulin almost always causes weight to go up. Decreasing insulin helps people lose weight. That can be accomplished by decreasing carbohydrate intake and by increasing insulin sensitivity. Cortisol levels have a direct impact on weight. Increasing cortisol increases weight gain. Decreasing cortisol does the opposite. Ghrelin is a hormone that's involved in hunger, telling you to eat. Leptin is sort of the opposite of ghrelin. It's a hormone that tells you you're full and you should stop eating. There are several other hormones, including thyroid, T3 and T4, testosterone in men, estradiol in women, that all have an impact on insulin resistance. If the level of those hormones are suboptimal, you're more likely to become insulin resistant, and you're also more likely to gain weight. And ask any woman who's gone into menopause about that. Weight gain is one of the first symptoms that comes up. To learn more about Jason Fung's insulin resistance paradigm, check out my video review of his book, The Diabetes Code. I've also got a review of the low-fat diet and exercise for weight loss approach that's taken by the Women's Health Initiative. Here are the links to those two videos. Be sure to like this video and subscribe to my channel to get notified whenever I post a new review. Thanks so much for watching, and I look forward to talking to you again soon.